die Initiative an der Basis und meine Wenigkeit. Wir haben diesen Event ins Leben gerufen, weil wir diese Notwendigkeit gesehen haben. Es ist das erste Mal, dass Ex-Muslime zusammenkommen, die tatsächlich vorher praktizierende Muslime waren und sich entschieden haben, irgendwo in ihrem Leben dann aufzuhören mit dem Islam und nicht nur stillschweigend sich zurückzuziehen, sondern aktiv gegen die islamische Ideologie zu sprechen. Und ich bin dankbar auch für die Anwesenden hier von Harris Sultan, Mohammed Hisham, der hat eine ganz dramatische Geschichte. Der Arme wurde zu einer TV-Show in Ägypten eingeladen, hat sich als Atheist vorgestellt, wurde dann in eine Diskussion verwickelt mit einem Kleriker von der Al-Azhar-Universität, der einflussreichsten sunnitischen Universität in der islamischen Welt. Er wurde noch in der TV-Show als geisteskrank bezeichnet. Der Gelehrte hat ihm gesagt, du brauchst medizinische Versorgung, du bist geisteskrank, du bist verwirrt, weil Mohammed Hisham sich angemaßt hatte, zu sagen, dass es auch noch andere Lebensmodelle außer dem Islam gibt. Was danach passierte, war eigentlich noch viel schrecklicher. Er wurde aus dem Studio geworfen von dem Moderator und von da ab verschwand Mohammed in den Untergrund, weil Leute nach seinem Leben trachteten. Und er hat es glücklicherweise durch Hilfe Dritter nach Deutschland geschafft. Und ich bin super dankbar, weil ich hatte ihn zu einer Zeit gesehen, wo ich mich an mich selber erinnert habe, als ich noch ein praktizierender Muslim war. Und damals, vor 10 Jahren, hätte ich gesagt, du Halunke, du, ja, wagst du es, diese wunderbare und tolle Religion in Frage zu stellen? Ich bin dankbar, dass ich miterleben durfte, dass er sicher nach Deutschland flüchten konnte und dass er heute unser Gast ist. Deswegen würde ich alle noch mal bitten, ihn herzlich zu begrüßen, weil der Mann wird bald vorzulegen.
First, I would like to thank the organizers for giving us this platform. Last year, I appeared on Egyptian TV declaring that I left Islam. Unfortunately, I have been met on air with aggression, hostility and humiliation. Later, I got physically assaulted and received many prison and death threats. It was a true manifestation of religious fascism. My freedom and personal safety became in danger. The situation was so disturbing, it even caught the attention of international newspapers and agencies, such as Times of Israel, Independent UK, Russia Today, and the Deutsche Welle. This is my story with Islam that led me up to this moment. I have grown up in a house where Islam is an integral part of almost every aspect of life. And like many Egyptian families, mine made sure that I'm properly introduced to Islam since a young age. When I was 6, I used to answer the calls for prayer in the mosque multiple times a day. And I used to go to a school specialized at teaching Quran. As you may know, religion takes advantage of children's lacks of proper critical thinking skills and abuse them through indoctrination and introducing them to irrational and abusive worldview. Learning about Islam in this young age was a traumatic experience for me. As a child, I used to have frequent nightmares about Judgment Day and disturbing fear from theological entities such as the devil. At the age of 8, I started to doubt everything I've learned, and I actually became agnostic. However, I kept my lack of belief to myself in fear of parental punishment. So I continued carrying on my Islamic routine as usual, until one day the imam at Friday prayers in the mosque wanted to play a probabilistic game on us. He said that Allah will answer your prayers if you pray right before dawn. It seemed like a cool experiment for an 8-year-old. I wake up right before dawn and said, Allah, if you are real, please make my math teacher, Jihan, be absent tomorrow because I didn't finish her homework. I went to school the next day to find that the teacher is absent. Later I discovered that she resigned. And actually my class spent 2 weeks without a math teacher. As you may have guessed, I unfortunately fell a victim to logical fallacies and false premise, and I became a Muslim again. I spent most of my teens as strict Muslim, which caused me much pain considering that my sexual orientation in Islam is viewed as perversion. And like many Muslim teens, I used to fantasize about jihad and dying in the name of Allah. Until I learned English and got exposed to Western philosophy and science, this led me to ditch Islam. It became obvious to me that the Quran made many mistakes while attempting to explain the natural world and that it essentially is a hate speech book. I realized that Muhammad, the founder of Islam and its most prominent figure, led a very inhuman and disturbing life. From enslaving innocent women for sex, to murdering people and stealing the land and wealth. Also philosophical topics such as the problem of evil, determinism, rendered the Abrahamic God to me as a mere logical fallacy. After leaving Islam, I felt peace toward myself and the world, but I started to grow apart from my community and society. Religious ideologies and its manifestation touches and mutilate everything in me now. It became very hard for me to integrate or make friends, given my disgust to my community's inhuman and Islamic-inspired way of life and mindset. However, I kept my lack of belief to myself and lived many years in isolation. But I carried on my Islamic routine as usual for appearances. Life in Islamic countries is easier this way. Well, generally this wasn't a pleasant period in my life. But later I made ex-atheist friends in real life thanks to Atheist Republic online groups. I really liked them and I felt that we should be the future and the present of Egypt, not the Islamists or the conservative Egyptians. Briefly after meeting my Egyptian atheist friends, an advertisement appeared in a closed Facebook group saying that a TV show in Cairo is looking for atheist participants to be interviewed. 95% of the comments were discouraging and negative, given that the potential consequences that await who will ever do this. It's a social and professional suicide, and consequences such as travel ban, jail, false arrest, physical assault are all expected outcomes. But sacrifices have to be made. Freedom don't come for free. I went to the show and I suffered for it. The footage of the interview was so disturbing it went viral overnight. Later my family saw me on TV and they had a very ugly response. A relative police officer physically assaulted me. They locked me up, took my money, threatened me with prison for breaking blasphemy law. Social media had all the evidence needed to put me on trial or behind bar, and given the situation of human rights in Egypt, it was not wise to challenge this. There are about 4 out of 100 million Egyptian citizens who got publicly known to be atheists while they are on Egyptian soils. Sharif Gaber, and he is currently hiding from Egyptian authorities, and if he got caught, it's expected that he spent a long time in jail. Me, the one who got away, and 2 other activists who are banned from traveling and essentially living under national security control. After the show, I went to social media and declared that I'm back to Islam, and I lived under my family's control until I escaped them and escaped the country. I managed to be here in safety and freedom thanks to many gracious humanists who offered all sorts of help. Special thanks to Troy Garno, my closest friend, who spent a lot of time, effort and money getting me out of this hardship. Thanks to Sam Harris, Mariam Namazi, Armin Nabawi, the International Humanist and Ethical Union and Secular Rescue, and many other gracious humanists who I will always be grateful and indebted to. I went to Germany for protection, but it didn't take me long to realize that my situation there is not as safe as I expected. Currently, in a way, I'm forced to live in a house surrounded by people coming from Islamic countries with the same mindset that leads to our persecution in MENA. At the first camp, I expressed myself naturally when residents asked me about my reasons for seeking protection in Germany, and I experienced verbal and physical harassment as a consequence. Luckily, I got transferred after a few days, but I learned my lesson, and now I pretend in front of my house and schoolmates to be a Muslim person, and I hide my sexual orientation to stay out of trouble. I'm glad that this is just a temporary situation, and I really hope that the German government managed to come up with even more effective ways to integrate them and neutralize these threats to human rights. Another thing that I find a little scary and very peculiar is that the German law still grants religion rights against some types of criticism. There are people in Germany who got in legal troubles for ridiculing or insulting religion. Unlike people, ideologies should not have rights. It's injustice to us atheists to be ridiculed and insulted in many religious books, and it would be illegal for us to publicly disrespect these books or refute them via mockery. This seems to me as a lingering ruins of religious fascism, and I hope it disappears in the future. However, the interaction between blasphemy laws, if they persisted, and the rise of Muslim population in the West might make for interesting times. Regarding my plans to the future, I'm going to start an Arabic show to support Egyptian LGBT, since that nobody's actually doing this. And I'm going to learn German and hopefully find nice work in the IT sector, since that I'm an electrical engineer. But my future is not so foreseeable, since that my asylum request got denied. They basically concluded that Egypt, a country with Sharia law, is safe for a public gay ex-Muslim. The decision is simply detached from the reality of my part of the world. They disregarded my experience in the Egyptian law and the situation of human rights in my country. But currently the decision is being challenged in court. Wish me luck and safety. Thank you for listening.